finish the course, joining within us that the power of the risen Lord. Let the cross be our glory, and the Lord be our song. By mercy made holy, by the Spirit made strong, let the cross be our glory, and the Lord be our song. Till the likeness of Jesus be through us made known, let the cross be our glory, and the Lord be our song. Let it be said of us, we were marked by forgiveness, we were known by our love, and delighted in meekness, we were ruled by his peace, heeding unity's call, joined as one body, that Christ would be seen by all. Let the cross be our glory, and the Lord be our song. By mercy made holy, by our Spirit made strong, let the cross be our glory, and the Lord be our song. Till the likeness of Jesus be through us made known, let the cross be our glory, and the Lord be our song.
Welcome. Our narthex notes this morning are for Vivian Gorman. She is having some upcoming surgery she's planned on, and she is requesting our prayers as she prepares for that. The other narthex note is for the family of Ron Gill, who passed away Thursday very unexpectedly. He is to be cremated in Texas, and it's my understanding the family will likely have a memorial service back here at some point in the future. So please be holding Vivian and Rose Gill and their family in your prayers. Also, we have a prayer request from Phil Hahn. Please be praying for Phil and his family, as Phil's sister, Christine Bashista, passed away this week in Massachusetts, and Phil will be preparing to do her funeral service there. So please be holding Phil and his family in your prayers also. In addition to the people listed in the prayer concern box in your bulletin. Be sure you look over the bulletin and the calendar page insert so you know what's going on in the life of the church. A couple of things I want to bring to your attention. CWF Ladies Night Out is May 7th at 6:00. The cost will be $20. This year it is being held at Casa del Roma. There's a sign-up sheet in the narthex, and you can see Becky Springsteen if you have any questions. The Free the Girls bra packing party this week has been canceled. A reminder, today is the deadline to order Easter lilies. And I have called a worship servant group meeting with the elders and Reverend Dave this Wednesday at 6:30. To discuss possible changes to worship in the weeks to come. Today, communion will be just a little different to further reduce potential contamination, but we didn't want to do away with communion for those who really need to be a part of that. We will not be practicing by intinction, as it indicates in the bulletin, nor will we be passing trays. Individual cups of wafers and of juice are available, and they're spread out on the communion table. We'll give you some more information when it comes time for communion. We're asking that you please be respectful of one another and allow distance between yourself and any non-family members. If you look around, you'll notice we have plenty of room to spread out. You can each have your own row, I bet. Also, the CWF visitation day that was planned this week is postponed. Hopefully, we'll be able to do that later this spring. We won't be passing attendance books this morning, but prayer request cards and an attendance book are available in the narthex if you would like to sign that.
Brothers and sisters, come, for Jesus bids us welcome. He would have us receive God's peace and God's grace. Yet we allow ourselves to dwell in the midst of doubt and fear. Jesus offers us hope and healing, but he also commands us to forgive freely and to all. Yet we persist in our ways of stubbornness and greed. Jesus, come among us once more, and be to us God's word. Open our hearts, our spirit, and our souls, that we might turn from sin and receive what you would tell us. God is loving and faithful. Therefore, accept the grace of forgiveness, but accept also the will and power to truly change. Amen. Amen indeed. Please now join in singing, Change My Heart, O God. Be seated. Before we offer our petitions and concerns, Before we lift our heart in thanksgiving and praise, let's take a deep breath. Let the quiet of the sanctuary quiet the busyness in our mind. Quiet our thoughts and steady our idle hands to focus on being in the presence of God. Let us feel God's presence in this moment of silence. Heavenly Father, we lift up our hearts in praise and thanksgiving for your abundant blessings each and every day. We explore this Lenten season to get closer to you in the stories of Holy Week and the gift of, the greatest gift of perfect love and forgiveness, forgiveness of our sins, when you lay down your life for our salvation. That love and promise gives us all the hope in this life. It carries us through difficult times, calms our fears, restores our faith, and when we falter, gives us strength to persevere day after day. Lord, life is fragile, but with confidence we lift up those of our family who are ill. Restore them to their health. Those who are grieving, may they be comforted. Those that are hungry, that they may be fed. Those who are lonely, that they may feel your loving embrace. Lord, bless those who work tirelessly to care for the ill, to protect this great nation, and to respond to emergencies at a moment's notice. Bless all the many people who do your work of justice and mercy here on earth. Lord, thank you for loving us so much, for forgiving us so often, day after day, for teaching us how to live in peace, that we can always rely on your saving grace. We thank you for sending us your Son, who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
so incredibly glad you're here. She definitely gets an A. Well, Amanda, got a couple things for you. And I'll be talking to you as well. It's been a heck of a week, I'm sure you would agree. News dominated by this guy, which you recognize, I know, by now as COVID-19. Last Sunday, we went over some ways that kids like you, people like you, can help fight this thing. One, stay healthy. Eat right, exercise daily, get lots of sleep. And then we also mentioned, sneezing right, coughing into your elbow, and if you do sneeze into a handkerchief, throw it away. We also mentioned washing hands and wiping hands, whatever. If you do use a wipe, then of course throw it in the trash. Stuff you knew, man, I know that. Now, do that every month, every week? No. Do it pretty much all the time, is the point. But because the whole world has decided that we need to stop this thing, right now, God has helped our medical experts come up with some special things we need to do at this moment, not forever, but for right now. One, you all know this. I expect you understand. That's why the school was closed. Is your school closed? Yeah, it is. Okay. Well, we need to stop meeting in large groups and sitting real close together and where we close enough to cough at each other and that kind of thing. You know about that. We should avoid contact with people who are sick or infirm. For now, it's better to call grandma rather than go see her. And if, man, I don't know if this is true for you, but I know a couple of kids this is true for. If you were looking forward to some kind of special big event, going to a park or going to play a game or whatever, then and you found out that it's got canceled, I have a suggestion, which is, and this is true for all of us, that we just kind of accept it. I mean, after all, we can whine about it, but that does absolutely no good to anybody. It won't be forever, but we need to put up with it. And here's something, Amanda, just for you. If you realize that the adults around you are just going crazy or losing it somehow or maybe getting depressed or getting really anxious, a favor to ask of you, not mentioning any adults who might be doing this, but if they go nuts on you, give them some slack. And I would ask you all to do the same for the kids in your lives, because it is kind of a crazy time, and maybe most important, remember, it's not your fault. It's this guy's fault. So, with that, there's one last thing that we really need to do, and this is kind of for all of us. I would like us all to spend some special time in prayer. I'm going to end with a special kind of prayer, listing many of the things concerning the virus and our response to it. Amanda, I'll tell you what, come out here and sit where Kathy is, and Kathy, if you could take her spot and come up. Kathy's going to read the individual lines, but would like the rest of us to join Amanda and sing parts of the Amen chorus. And we'll just sing one word, and then three words, and all those words will be Amen. So you'll recognize it as it comes by. Let's see how we do. Kathy, start us off. Let's pray.
Dear God, we lift up to you all the people who have or will have this virus. Give them strength and restore them to health. We ask it in Jesus' name.
Just the one word. Amen.
We pray for health workers trying to diagnose and treat those who are sick. Help them do their jobs safely and well. We ask it in Jesus' name.
Sing with me. Amen.
We pray for people whose jobs or savings are at risk because of the quarantine. Help them find whatever temporary fixes are needed and bless them with serenity in the face of so many unknowns.
Now we finish the song. Amen, amen, amen. Oh, sorry, Kathy. We're fighting. I'm pushing, and so is he. Okay, and there you go, Kathy. If you could read those for us. Sorry. Here, I'm sorry. I didn't leave you a sheet. I apologize. Here you go.
I'm going by that.
God, we lift up to you the researchers who are trying to come up with treatment and a vaccine. Bless them with success and bless the rest of us with patience. We ask it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
We pray for the countries and industries most affected by all this. May it help us realize we really are one interconnected world, wonderfully diverse, but united in being your beloved children. We ask it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Finally, Lord, we end by asking you to grace us all with your peace and with the knowledge that our future is safe in your hands. We ask it in Jesus' name.
Amen. 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 Thank you, Kathy. And thank you, Amanda, for coming up. You're a brave young woman. Well, we're not going to have children's worship for Amanda or any kids that come in weeks to come, for the time being at least, especially because Terry has a weak heart, frankly, and we want to give her a chance to stay away. But we'll ask all of our kids, Amanda, in your case, to go back and join their parents this time. But it's still time for all of us to practice the ministry of welcoming. And for this time, because of the times we're in, let me ask you to stand up where you are. So stand up. And let's wave to everybody. I figure that's about as safe as we can get. Okay, have a tear. At this time, I'll ask our scripture readers to come forward, and let's all now pay attention to the Word of God.
Good morning. Each Sunday in Lent, we are examining a scene from Holy Week and trying to imagine where we would have fit into it. Today, however, we'll start with a passage from the prophet Jesus quoted most often. This is Isaiah 29, verses 13 through 14, a passage that reflects how Jesus felt about many of the Pharisees.
The Lord said, "These people come near to me with their mouths and honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Their worship of me is based on merely human rules they have been taught.
Therefore, once more, I will astound these people with wonder upon wonder. The wisdom of the wise will perish. The intelligence of the intelligent will vanish."
In our main text, partway through Holy Week, Jesus tells a parable about the stewards of a vineyard who rejects the owner's messengers. When the owner then sends his son, they kill the young man rather than fulfill their responsibility as stewards. This is what happens next according to Luke chapter 20.
The teachers of the law and the chief priest looked for a way to arrest him immediately because they knew he had spoken this parable against them, but they were afraid of the people.
Keeping a close watch on him, they sent spies who pretended to be sincere. They hoped to catch Jesus in something he said so that they might hand him over to the power and authority of the governor.
So the spies questioned him, "Teacher, we know you speak and teach what is right, and that you do not show partiality, but teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. Is it right for us to pay taxes to Caesar or not?
He saw that through their duplicity and said to them, "Show me a denarius. Whose image and inscription are on it?"
"Caesar's," they replied.
He said to them, "Then give back to Caesar what is Caesar's, and give to God what is God's."
They were unable to trap him in what he had said there in public. And astonished by his answer, they became silent.
May God bless to our hearing and understanding these readings from the Holy Word.
Amen.
Thank you for that reading. The opponents who clash with Jesus in today's scripture are not just the Pharisees who have dogged his heels since Galilee. Now that he's actually in Jerusalem, the temple authorities, the priests there, are threatened by him as well. And usually, Pharisees and temple priests are oil and water. They don't get along at all. But in this instance, they're united by this strange common enemy. The priests see him as an enemy because, you may remember from last week, we went over this story, Jesus threw out the money changers and animal sellers who would only have been in the temple with their permission and, we can be pretty sure, their financial participation in whatever profits were made from this. They've just lost a huge revenue stream thanks to Jesus. But if we give the priests a little bit of benefit of the doubt, then we can also suspect that maybe they're worried because they have responsibility for the people in Jerusalem, and Jesus has quite the reputation as a rabble-rouser, one who could easily light the powder keg of a city bursting with Passover crowds. And by the way, that powder will get lit about 35 years after this story. The Jews finally do openly revolt, and the result is the complete destruction of Jerusalem, the leveling of the temple. 70 AD is a year that'll live in infamy for Jews everywhere. But the priests didn't know that it was that far ahead, and they did know that Rome was capable of that kind of thing, and they did not want to antagonize the Roman soldiers. Another reason that, from their point of view, Jesus simply had to go. As for the Pharisees, some of them, such as Nicodemus, liked Jesus. They weren't all enemies of him, but for many, what he taught just struck them as heresy. They worshiped a God who makes demands. Their scriptures, our Old Testament, are a set of rules. And a primary responsibility of every Jew, as they saw it, was to keep all those rules. If you didn't do that, you're going to hell in a handbasket. So this is a vital issue as far as they're concerned. Jesus, however, acted as though, talks as though, the scripture he likes has nothing to do with rules. The scripture Jesus seems to act on is God is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Isn't that special? Boy, just take all the might out of the scriptures as far as the Pharisees are concerned. And in truth, we sometimes find it easy to beat up on the Pharisees too much. They're not really Darth Vader, demonic. The community perceived them as religious men you would be proud to have in your synagogue or church because they attended faithfully, they tithed, they prayed, they worked hard to teach God's law. But according to Jesus, these missionaries for Judaism brought nothing but misery to their converts. Just for starters, Jesus said that the hundreds of rules the Pharisees had devised over the years for interpreting the law and properly obeying it, He said, all those things are just an unnecessary burden. Sometimes they even struck Jesus as practically silly. It's unlawful to heal somebody on the Sabbath. God, that's just an idiotic rule, thought Jesus, and he completely ignored it and healed away. To many of the Pharisees, the only thing that mattered was external compliance with the law. You could see it, you could touch it, it's existentially solid. But Jesus said, God looks at the heart. Which is why, for example, he equated a lustful look with the actual committing of adultery. And plus, when the Pharisees evangelized, they didn't go to any effort to introduce people to a God who loved them, but to convert them to their own brand of religion. Each rabbi had his own pet theories and wanted people to follow his particular sect of Judaism. Here are the rules I think are most important. Follow those. It's still a problem, by the way. William Barclay, many of you know him and have read some of his books, he said this: the greatest of all heresies is the sinful conviction that any church has a monopoly on God, or that any church is the only gateway to God's kingdom. Greatest of heresies, pretty strong language. It's something I resonate to. I appreciate it about our own denomination. We're part of the restoration movement out of which the Disciples of Christ sprang in the early 1800s out there on the American frontier. And our founding slogans included this one. Many of you know it. We are not the only Christians, but we are Christians only. Nice. Imagine, it's just giving carte blanche to say, you know, there are other Christians out there, and they may not all be like us, but we're Christian ourselves. I love it. Back to the topic, though. Jesus told his listeners to pay attention to the words of the Pharisees. Listen to what they say, but don't practice what they preach. Quote, they tie up heavy, cumbersome loads and put them on other people's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to lift a finger to move them. Everything they do is done for show. So you put all that together, and you can see why, for most of the Pharisees, Jesus is just anathema. He's somebody, they don't like him. And they join forces with the temple priests, and then they hire some spies, is the way our translation puts it. Some spies that are going to trick him up with a trick question. And what we're seeing in this painting that's on your bulletins is the moment when Jesus gives his famous answer. Now, as you may know by now, during Lent, we're inviting you to imagine yourself in Holy Week scenes like this one. And to help with that, I chose this soldier back there in the background and tried to write his backstory. As I've imagined him, he's the son of a poor farmer who enlisted 17 years ago for lack of any kind of financial prospect. And the story, by the way, about the healed servant that we're going to hear him quote is in Luke 7, 1 to 10. But this soldier's name, as I've given it, is Octavian.
I admit it. I'm exhausted. We only arrived in Jerusalem 2 days after Pilate marched our entire 6,000-man legion from Caesarea to reinforce the garrison here during the Jewish festival of Pentecost. I'm still lugging 45 pounds of armor and weaponry, but at least I was able to leave my food, tools, and supplies at the camp we set up instead of carrying it back on my back as well. Of course, I carted all 85 pounds on the 3-day, 65-mile journey here. Shouldn't complain, though. 10 years ago, in the Germania campaign, I had to carry all that and build the road we marched on before engaging in some of the most brutal fighting I've ever seen. We buried too many of my brothers for me to remember that as a great Roman victory. Actually, the whole glory of the empire can go to the crows as far as I'm concerned. I've only got 8 of my 25 years of required service left, and then I will be done with the marching and the order-taking, and especially the fighting and killing. I've served under some centurions who seem to enjoy bloodshed. I'm good at it. You have to be, as much as we train, but I'm glad I never took pleasure in inflicting pain. That may be why I'm so impressed with the current centurion in charge of our 100-man company, Commander Julius. He's hard, like a soldier has to be, but he's fair and even kind when it's possible. He ordered me to watch over this Jesus character, to arrest him if he does something treasonous, but much more likely to protect the man if the temple guards or religious leaders try to hurt him. Jesus is a preacher and healer who seems to be a combination of gentle teacher. He tells people to love their enemies, meaning us. And rabble-rouser, you should have seen him clear out the swindlers and scam artists yesterday. I've overheard intriguing stories about Jesus, miracles and the like. The best one was one that Commander Julius told. Last summer, he heard Jesus speak and was so impressed he asked him to heal his servant. This was his favorite slave, and the commander was convinced Jesus could command disease and paralysis the way Julius commands us. It sounded ridiculous, but the commander said Jesus healed his servant from a distance, without even seeing or laying hands on the man. I don't know if I believe it, but I do like the way Jesus stands up to his own religious leaders. Even Rome recognizes that Judaism is a uniquely powerful religion. Of all the people we've conquered, they alone have a temple as impressive as anything you'd see in Rome. And they resisted any imposition of Roman worship so fiercely that the two emperors decided it wasn't worth the fight. Jews are the only ones who don't have to burn incense to the emperor. And our eagle bearer has to hide the legion's standard when we marched into the city, lest we offend their no graven image policy. I respect them for that. Plus, the Jews' insistence on only one God sounds right to me. But the Jewish leaders? Blah! Most of them strike me as pious jerks who don't care about their own people, but give themselves all kinds of credit for following their own nitpicky rules. Some of the men talking to Jesus now are minions of those leaders, and they're trying to get him to say anything that will break Jewish or Roman law. But I'm glad to see he is way too smart for them. Now that I think about it, I hope we never have to arrest Jesus. I'm starting to understand why the commander likes him so much.
Octavian, one bystander as I saw him. In the 1984 election, some of you old enough like I am to remember, Ronald Reagan was 73, then the oldest president in American history. And in trying for a second term, his age became potentially a huge issue, especially because during his first debate with Walter Mondale, Reagan occasionally lost focus and seemed confused, and after the first debate, his poll numbers just took a nosedive. But in the second debate, Reagan was asked, point blank, should age be an issue? And his answer was, well, I will not make age an issue of this campaign. I'm not going to exploit for political purposes my opponent's youth and inexperience. And I remember even Walter Mondale had to laugh. The whole world laughed. And some historians think that Reagan clinched his reelection with that one line. At the very least, it was so clever that his opponents were afraid to even talk about age after that, lest by comparison they seem plodding and ridiculous. And I think something similar happened in our story today when Jesus confronted the toadies of the religious leaders. His answer wasn't a joke exactly, but it sure shut everybody up. Consider this. The Roman coin that he asked them to show him, it bears the image of the emperor. And Jesus says, well, he's on the coin. Belongs to him. Give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar. But what bears the image of God? Us. We do. In the very first chapter of Genesis, we're told that God said, "Let us make humankind in our own image, according to our likeness." So we may owe the government our taxes, but we owe God, us, everything that we are, our very life. Jesus, I contend, in this answer is inviting us to acknowledge that a government does indeed have a right to expect a certain amount of allegiance. But that allegiance is limited because what we owe God is everything. And when earthly authority conflicts with God's authority, well, every individual has to choose. But aren't you glad that Jesus made his choice obvious? Amen. Amen. Well, with that, John, it's time to raise our screen, if you would, and we're going to prepare for offering in communion with hymn number 180. So please turn to 180, if you would, and join in singing, "Lord, Who Throughout These 40 Days."
Lord, who throughout these 40 days for us did fast and pray, teach us with you to mourn our sins and close by you to stay.
The deacons will now collect our offering for the work of the Lord's Church.
Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless and approve these offerings given with humble and contrite hearts. Let them be used for the glory of your name here and throughout the world. Amen. Amen. Please be seated.
Would you pray with me? Lord, it's been a difficult week. So much is on our minds that we pick up from constant news reports with updates, what's going on with the virus throughout the world. Lord, we are conflicted. We feel threatened. We have compassion for others. And yet, we ask you to protect us. When we feel under threat, we become very self-focused. As we gather around your table, help us intentionally shift our focus fully upon you, O Lord. May this simple wafer and this simple sip of juice truly be for us your broken body and your blood poured out for us. We need your nourishment. We need your presence. We need your guidance, your strength to rise above fear, to act responsibly, and to always remember that you are with us through whatever life brings. Please bless these elements. Help us share with others the trust, the faith we have in you. We ask in your name, Lord. Amen.
We gather here together the same way the disciples gathered together so many years ago. They came to remember freedom from captivity. And we come to remember freedom from sin. So Jesus on that night took an ordinary piece of bread. He blessed it, he broke it, he gave thanks to you, Lord God, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body broken for you." And in the same way, he took an ordinary cup of wine, again giving thanks and praise to you, Almighty God. He blessed it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, drink. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of a new and everlasting covenant for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you take this bread and drink this cup, remember me." He is always with us. The table is prepared, and all are welcome.
As I mentioned several minutes ago, we're doing communion just a little differently this morning. We would ask that you come forward and take a wafer in a cup, tip it into your mouth, and then drop the cup in the wastebasket, and then move over and take a cup of juice, drink it, and drop it in the wastebasket. And then if you like, you may proceed to the painting and continue to sprinkle more ash on the painting. It is evolving on its way to Easter. And then if you desire, you can go to the prayer wall and write a prayer, whatever that needs to be, and leave it among the rocks. And then we have stops in the back where you can pick up reflection sheets pertaining to the pictures that we're using each Sunday. So one table has the picture from last Sunday, and one table has the picture from today. You are welcome to take that with you. And then the final stop that's available has candles to light if you would like to participate in that and light a candle for whatever is on your heart today, and then return to your seat. All are welcome at the Lord's table. And now it's time for our hymn of invitation. That is the time when anyone who desires to make a confession of their faith within the context of becoming a member here at First Christian, you are invited to come forward during the hymn. And now, if you are able, please stand, and together let us sing number 611, Rise Up, O Saints of God. Brothers and sisters, as we leave this place of sanctuary, go in peace, the peace that overcomes fear, the peace like that that only comes from God, God who created you, God who has saved you, and God who will sustain you always. Through whatever life brings your way, know you are loved that much. Amen. Amen. Amen.